Hi, everybody. If you could just find your way to your seats or make yourself comfortable. My name is Robert Scheer. I'm a member of the Board of Selectmen and also a member of the Ashland Upper Charles Trail Committee. Close. How's this? Okay. All right. Let me get my... All right. So we're hoping... our plan is to get everybody out of here by 9 o'clock. I'm just going to do a short introduction, kind of set the scene a little bit. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay, very good. Bathrooms are out down the hall to the right. Okay, now we got that out of the way. And there are some refreshments in the back. Please feel free to get up and help yourself. This is going to be informal. Set the scene, this is a process. This is our effort to join the Upper Charles Trail, which is an existing trail in Milford and Holliston, five towns. The other towns would be Hopkinton and Sherburn. So if any of you have ever been on the Milford Trail or the Holliston Trail, you know what it's like, and it's beautiful and a great amenity. I just wanted, the Upper Charles Trail Committee was appointed by the Board of Selectmen almost 3 years ago, and I was appointed to that committee, and after I was appointed, I looked at it and it said, end of term until completed. So that was somewhat ominous. So I did want to recognize the members of the Board of Selectmen who have been very involved and very supportive. I would ask if they could just stand so people could see them, so you could feel free to discuss with them anything you feel about the trail. And they've really been staying. I've been briefing them, but they've also been coming to meetings and are very interested. So I think Carl Hackinson's here in the back. Carl, if you want to wave to people. Steve Mitchell is here in the middle. Thank you, Steve. And Yolanda Greaves is here. So thank you. I want to thank the members of the board for your support over the years and for your continued interest. The other thing I wanted to briefly do was have the members of the Upper Charles Trail Committee just stand up, and it's chaired by Joel Arbeitman, I think most people know. Tony Lewis is there at the table. Martin Ring here. Valerie is here. Valerie Paul is here, and David Rosenblum is here somewhere, and Preston Crowe in the back there. Okay, thank you. And Rick Hampson, how could I forget Rick? Rick, thank you, Rick. I did also want to briefly recognize Sheila Page, our new town planner, who's standing over here. And thank you. Sheila's taking a leadership role in this, is going to be our town staff person. This really is an important planning project. And, thank you for Sheila for coming forward to help be our project manager on this. So I'm going to turn this over to Joel in a moment, who will introduce Alta Planning, who's running the presentation tonight. The idea here is we've been doing some work over the past few years. We have some things to show you, but the most important thing here is to get for you to learn about what we've been doing, how we're approaching this, and to give us your feedback and thoughts on this. Just a note. I'm interested in this because it's a great recreational opportunity. It'll add to our quality of life. It also has other almost commercial or day-to-day living. We all know how we're overwhelmed by traffic, increased traffic. This is a way to decrease our carbon footprint, get out of the cars a little bit for you and your friends and your children, whether you're going to school or you're going to downtown or you're going shopping. So it's not just going out, riding a bike, seeing the nice sights, which it certainly is, and getting exercise. But it's also something that could potentially integrate into everyday life as a way of getting out of the car, and one of our few options here in the suburbs to not driving our cars everywhere. So we're certainly cognizant of some of the issues. Ashland has a very unique challenge in that we do not have an old rail trail or old rail bed right away that's been preserved. I did find out, we actually do have an old railroad line, which I'm sure some people, in a trolley line that some people know about here, but I wasn't aware of that. But so that's our unique challenge. I would just ask people, as you go through this process, to keep in mind that we're trying to build something here for the good of the community. And it is complicated and difficult and more challenging than usual here in Ashland. So With that, I just want to turn over to Joel Arbeitman, the chair of the Upper Charles Trail Committee. And Joel really has been one of the driving forces behind it. He's been working for years now. And Joel, I wanted to thank you for your efforts. And come on up here and take over.
Thank you, Rob. Everybody can hear okay? Way in the back. I just want to give a little bit of the history about how we came to be here today. Some 15 or 20 years ago, a couple of people, I really think of them as dreamers, from Holliston and from Milford specifically, Robert Wideneck in Holliston and Reno DeLuzio, who was the former planner in the town of Milford, had a dream, really, to try to build a rail trail. And a rail trail, as you probably know, means that you take over an abandoned rail bed. It's already existing, and you make the surface better, and you have a trail. It's pretty straightforward. It's not easy, but it's straightforward. And those guys started building their trails, and then one day, I don't know how this happened, but they came up and they said, you know what, we have a bigger dream. We want to even do better than what we were doing for our own town. We want to build a regional trail for walking and for biking and any other use, really, other than motorized vehicles. And what we'd like to do is have the three other towns become part of a 30-mile loop. That's what they're targeting to do. And that those other towns would include Sherbourne, Ashland, and Hopkinton. So that the path would be a full circle. You could go out for a long walk, 30-mile walk, or a bike ride. So they contacted our town and other towns, and we jumped in. And at the time, there was really just a very small group of people who were actively working with them on trying to figure out how we would even begin to approach something like that. And what we chose to do very early in our process was approach Ashland's Board of Selectmen. And it's important not just to thank them for being here tonight, but for really being strong supporters and recognizing the value of what this trail could mean to Ashland. They've been supportive from day one. We also have had tremendous support from Mike Herbert, our town manager, and from Sheila was mentioned, our town planner, and others in town on the town staff. The committee people have, many of us have been on this committee just from the time it was formally appointed by the selectmen for more than 2 years now. It's a lot of meetings and a lot of nights and a lot of days. We've spent a tremendous amount of time with many other people here in Ashland walking the trails, possible places trails could go, and trying to really learn where there were steep slopes and easy slopes and what gave us the best scenery and so on. And one thing that's really important, I think you've all probably heard the, maybe it's a corny cliche, when life hands you lemons, make lemonade. Well, we were handed lemons here in Ashland. We got some tough stuff. We don't have a rail trail to speak of. If we have any, we have little pieces of one, but it really doesn't connect to very much. It's not, we can't use that as the main trail that we're seeking to have. But what that did was it put us in a position where we had to be very creative and try to find a way to weave through the town, connecting all of the key locations in town, downtown, the state parks, Route 126 and all the condos over there, the schools and so on, and try to tie the entire community together at all these key destinations. And I think if we had had an existing rail trail, that's where the trail would be going. There wouldn't be a lot to discuss. It would just be put down where it's supposed to go. But here we had an opportunity. And so I really feel like the research we've done, the research we'll continue to do, is trying to make lemonade out of those lemons. And I think we can actually end up with a much improved trail if we're able to accomplish it. So to conclude this, I just want to point out that last year, we began a study evaluating some of the consulting firms to have professionals come in and provide guidance to us in our process. And we went through a very lengthy process evaluating several different firms. We put an RFP out. We got all kinds of responses to it. We went through a painstaking process of really evaluating each vendor. We had interviews with them. We pored over and had a rating system of their proposals. And out of all of that, we're very excited to talk about that we hired a company who's here tonight called Alta Planning and Design. And what especially impressed me were two really key things, in addition to meeting the people from the company. One was that this is all they do, trails. They're not an engineering and architecture company where they're planning roads or building bridges or putting up skyscrapers. They don't do that. They do what we need to have done here. The second thing that I thought was incredibly impressive was in their response to our request for proposal, they have designed and developed over 8,000 miles of trails. I mean, that's staggering. That's almost back and forth and back again across the country if you think about the length of those trails. They've already done this. So they're extremely experienced. So to get this moving along, I just want to introduce the project leader from Alta Planning and Design, and let's give him a nice warm Ashland welcome, Mr. Phil Goff. Phil?
Thanks, Joel. Thanks, that was a great intro. And I wish I could take credit for those 8,000 miles. I can't personally, but I do have, you know, quite a bit of experience with trail planning, and it's terrific to be here in Ashland to do this work. And I have to give credit to Joel and the rest of the committee for allowing us as consultants to come in and not necessarily start from square one as we do in other communities that you've done a lot of work. You have some ideas for alignment and connections and where you want to link to. You've done some analysis, and a website was already developed, so that really sort of got us going in the right direction. So I wanted to thank you for that. Just a tiny bit more of an introduction about our team. So this is a team. It's not just Alta Planning and Design. We are the lead consultants, and we are, Joel's right, we don't do just trails, but we exclusively plan, design, and engineer pedestrian and bicycle facilities, complete streets, trails, greenway systems, do a lot of bike share planning as well. For those that have seen maybe Hubway downtown, we do a lot of that. So walking, bicycling, it's really in our blood at Alta. We're a Portland, Oregon-based company where cycling is a big, big deal out there, as is, you know, almost all outdoor activities. And we have smaller offices around the U.S., and we have a office in Cambridge, and that's sort of the base of our New England planning and design operations. So along with Alta, or along with me tonight, is Charlie Cray, who is the sort of the lead planner with me on this project. And we have a senior landscape architect in the Cambridge office as well. And we have folks from around the country who have as much or more experience planning and designing trails and greenways who are part of this effort as well. We also have a sub-consultant. Alta do not have a core engineering practice in Cambridge, so we have a sub-consultant, Kleinfelder, to provide civil and environmental engineering extra capacity and expertise on the team. This early on in the stage, they haven't really done so much, but and we don't have a rep from Kleinfelder here today, but Kleinfelder will begin to get involved, and they're experts on a lot of the environmental mitigation strategies and design issues, permitting, and cost estimating as well. So at the next meeting, we'll have the opportunity to welcome Mike Cunningham from Kleinfelder as well. So I'm going to just mosey over here and turn off the lights, because there's I've got about 35 or 40 slides here. Some are pretty detailed and graphic. There are a couple extra seats if someone wants to really get close, closer to the screen to be able to see. But if not, we'll start right up. And first want to make sure everyone understands what we'll be doing tonight, both in the PowerPoint presentation, but also just in general afterwards in terms of collecting community feedback. And that, of course, is a big part of what we're doing, is here to present you with a little bit about some of our experience and background, but we want to talk about the benefits of trails. Just briefly, this isn't a lecture course, but just want to touch base for a couple of minutes to make sure everyone understands. Joel talked a little bit about the importance of trails and what it could do for Ashland, and Robin mentioned that, you know, giving people an opportunity to get out of their cars is a good one for folks in Ashland, so we want to talk a little bit about that. We'll talk a little bit about the regional context that some of you are likely aware of what the other communities are doing, but I just want to highlight a little more specifically what folks are doing. And then we'll talk a bit about some of the opportunities and the challenges for developing, planning, and then ultimately developing a trail through Ashland. And this process has really just started. We had our kickoff meeting with the committee about 6 weeks ago, I believe, and we've had some snowy weather since then, so we've done some field work, but the analysis is, in essence, just beginning. But we want to, at least in a portion of the presentation, give you some of our thoughts and observations sort of early on in this stage, but obviously the analysis is ongoing. I'll talk a little bit about next steps in the process, which will conclude the presentation, and at the end of the presentation, we'll open it up for some general Q&A for maybe 15 or 20 minutes. And when that is complete, then we'll have sort of an open house style for maybe a half an hour. It'll probably be 45 minutes to an hour from now. We will sort of formally conclude the plenary Q&A, but give people opportunities to circulate around, go to the two tables in the back, which I know some people have already gone to, the one table in the front. At each of those tables, we'll have members of the committee or consultants or the town planner. Sheila, the town planner, will be at some of those tables. All the maps at each of the tables are the same, so it's sort of at your discretion which one you want to go to. And we want to hear your comments more specifically and write them down on the maps. Give us your ideas for where you think there could be some great opportunities to connect the trail, places where perhaps you're concerned about the trail running for various reasons, so we want to get all that down on map too. It isn't just about asking some questions and receiving some answers. So that's in essence what the evening will look like, and then we'll have you all out of here by 9, or perhaps a little bit earlier. So again, to jump in just for a few slides on the benefits of trails, because it is a lot of what I do and what our company does, and we feel very strongly that trails bring a whole lot of benefits to various communities. I'd say sort of the three kind of key benefits, you know, overall are transportation, public health, and economic. I'll sort of go through those in a little more detail. In terms of the transportation benefits, I mean, I think, you know, Rob said it well, that, you know, when you have infrastructure that isn't just, you know, roadways for buses and motor vehicles, when you have infrastructure that's trail infrastructure or bike lanes and others, or bike infrastructure, sidewalks, et cetera, you're obviously providing that alternative method, different method of getting around town. So that's sort of a key and very obvious transportation method or transportation benefit. But the connectivity that a well-designed and planned trail can offer to allow people connectivity to job centers and commercial districts is really critical, and we know that's a big part of our major goal here in Ashland is to connect to downtown. We want to look at opportunities to connect to schools as well, and a real benefit is creating a sort of what a lot of planners use the term as safe routes to school, where you're providing opportunities for children to walk and bike to school. In terms of the ability to satisfy pedestrian desire lines, if you're walking, even with a good sidewalk system, oftentimes there are parts of town you want to get to. There are connections that would be ideal that a street with a sidewalk doesn't necessarily get you there. A trail, whether it's along a rail bed or elsewhere, can actually help you get from one part of town to the other quite quickly on a bicycle or walking, and that's really a key transportation benefit. And for those with disabilities, I mean, imagine if you're walking from one part of Ashland to another, if you're blind or if you're in a wheelchair, even if there's a sidewalk from end to end, there's curb cuts, sometimes there's missing ramps, you have to cross at intersections, a well-connected trail allows a more seamless experience for those with disabilities as well. So that's a real key benefit. And you know, when a community provides that infrastructure, that is a way, has some level of separation from motor vehicles, you're providing a facility that people who are more novice at bicycling especially can feel more comfortable, or those riding with their kids, to really sort of induce more of that ridership or walking. So those are, you know, the kind of clear transportation benefits of trails for particular communities. Public health benefits, you know, it's kind of sort of obvious on its face. You know, you have this infrastructure You're encouraging more people to walk and bike in a community. And there are certain reasons why that's important for every community throughout the Commonwealth and throughout the U.S. But the reality is for various reasons, and some of those reasons are because folks in rural areas and suburban areas drive more, and accidents and collisions have a higher likelihood of that happening in rural and suburban areas than in urban areas. But overall, there are three fewer years of life expectancy. And part of that is, and that's a public health issue, and part of that is simply the somewhat more sedentary lifestyles that some folks have in suburban and rural areas. 20% of adults generally are not getting this or recommended levels of daily exercise, which really only needs to be about 20 minutes of some sort of active transportation or some sort of level of activity. And trails really provide that sort of perfect opportunity in one's community where you can go for a walk or a quick bike ride for maybe 20 minutes, and that's a real sort of public health benefit for a particular community. Economic benefits are varied amongst trails, and they will vary, of course, depending on the type of community you're in. But generally, and there's a whole bunch of studies that show that having trails, well-designed trails through communities, will increase property values of both commercial and residential properties adjacent to those trails. And in areas or for communities, and I don't know enough about Ashland to know exactly where you're looking for new development and where those opportunities are. I'm not a land use planner here in this context, but certainly in other communities, in the image here of the Minuteman Trail in Arlington, and you see this in a few other communities in New England where trails are built, the property value will increase to a point where redevelopment may occur. In this case, in that particular image, if you could see it, is a redevelopment of the Brigham Square site in Arlington that used to be just sort of one-story commercial building and lots of surface parking on the left, and now that project was replaced by a four-story residential building with 116 housing units and some mixed use and retail. And a big part of what triggered that was having the trail nearby, and that trail about 2 miles to the right or to the east brings you right to Alewife Station, the end of the red line. So that makes this property and this redevelopment a highly valuable one for a developer to build and to provide lots of opportunities for people to bike or, if they're really hardy, to walk the 2 miles to get to the T station. Here's from the ground, that's generally on the Minuteman Trail what that project looks like, little retail pavilion, mixed use commercial building, and the four-story residential. I live in Arlington, by the way, so I've got a couple slides here of the Minuteman because I do ride it quite a bit myself and with my kids. And there, besides the Brigham Square development that does have the retail pavilion near the corner, the Minuteman path has really sort of helped Arlington Center and other parts of Arlington develop economically. Certainly for places, eating and drinking locations, whether it's a coffee shop or a bar or a restaurant. The path goes right through Arlington Center. You see lots of bikes parked in places. And in developments like the Trader Joe's, at one point there wasn't a stair connection down to the old rail line. Of course, why would there be? But at some point after the Minuteman was developed, that stairway was put in. And they put in bike parking, and Trader Joe's and Starbucks have their signs out there. And a lot of people will park there and go up the stairs and do their shopping there. So there's that real kind of clear economic benefit in terms of development, both smaller scale in terms of shops and businesses, but also potentially the larger scale, like that Brigham Square. There are a number of other benefits that trails can bring to community. The public health can help to reduce the overall healthcare costs, and for employers in your community to reduce or increase worker productivity. And that helps to keep and maintain and recruit staff, talented staff for that particular business. It also helps to brand a particular community, a town or a city. I know in Arlington, it isn't the official logo necessarily, but you see a lot of sort of branded logos that talk about Arlington, Arlington Center, and they'll have a bicycle on it. The Board of Selectmen always talk about Arlington as being a bike town. So I think it's part of sort of a branding opportunity for a community as well. And then there's the opportunity, especially if you connect in with the other communities nearby as part of the Upper Charles Trail, which connect further on to other parts of the regional greenway and trail system, you have the opportunity to even induce some bicycle-related tourism, tourists who might be coming to Boston to do a lot of biking around the region. There is that opportunity here as well. For those interested in really wanting to read even more about the benefits, especially the economic benefits, we put together on the website. And the website for this project is on the Ashland Bike Club website, so the ashlandbikeclub.com. And you see on the bottom left, there is a tab there for the Upper Charles Trail Committee, and we have a tab for trail studies, and there's a whole bunch in there that get into more of the details about the benefits of trails. There's a couple in there that are, we try to stay as local as possible. There's some in there related to the Minuteman Path and other trails in Massachusetts. So to give everyone a little sense of context of where we are here in Ashland and how you fit into the Upper Charles Trail, which Joel talked about as a 30-mile loop with Ashland up in the upper right corner. Of course, I wanted to just quickly take you through this loop so you have a sense of where other communities are and what they've done recently. Many of you are likely familiar and have been to these other communities, know people in other communities, and I know there are folks here who are advocates for trails in those communities as well. And welcome, thank you for coming to Ashland and weighing in here as well. So in terms of progress on this 30-mile, this dream of this 30-mile loop, which is really quite spectacular as a long-term dream, but things are moving along in a handful of communities. In Sherbourne, there is a purchase and sales agreement with CSXT from Whitney Street South to the Holliston line. So there, that property is now in the hands of Sherbourne and are moving forward in getting some kind of trail connection through that piece. In Holliston, which is obviously a significant stretch of the Upper Charles Trail, there are portions of the trail that are complete. The lines that are in pink are sections that are complete. And there are other sections that are still under development. There's also recently been a couple of new flashing yellow beacons installed on Central Street and Lowland Street crossings. So that yellow is the unimproved trail. The pink is the improved portion of trail, but much of that is rail line. So they do have that advantage certainly over Ashland. Milford is the only community within the Upper Charles Loop that's in essence fully developed its portion of the trail. I'm sure many of you have been on this. It's a paved, I don't have the mileage, but probably 6 or 7 miles would be my guess looking at the scale, paved trail that runs on portions of rail line, but then also through the town area. A paved 10-foot trail, and for those of you who have been on it, that's something important to keep in mind for how we really envision the character of the trail, which I'll talk about a little bit later, but the character of the trail in Ashland, and does the community want portions of the trail or the whole trail to have a look and feel more like Milford or something more rustic perhaps and narrower? And that's one of the key questions on your evaluation sheet. Did everyone get the evaluation response sheet, I hope? Or the comment form, the community comment form? Yeah, there's extras on the back table. There's a couple questions there. One is, in fact, about the trail character, which we'd love to have you answer. But we got a stack. I think there's some in the back table. But make sure you pick one up, because this is a great way for us to really quantify the comments that the community makes, not just in the Q&A that we'll have quite soon and markups on the map, but for individuals to fill out this comment form is really important for us as well. Hopkinton has three concurrent feasibility studies going on. VHB is working with the town, looking at three different facets of the portion of the trail through Hopkinton. There is a 0.7-mile town-owned former railroad parcel that is part of the trail. And there is a portion, a stone dust portion that is already complete. And they have some real significant challenges that are not so unlike Ashland's in terms of dozens of privately owned formal railroad parcels. So it's not just sort of a simple single parcel owned by a particular railroad. And there are some terrain issues there, private property issues, wetlands. Some of the same things that we're confronting here as part of our work. And then, of course, in Ashland, just last month, starting with the hiring of Alta to do this work. We are looking at all the opportunities and challenges. And one of those in particular is the Bay Circuit Trail, which right now it's pretty low-key and subtle. There's a few signs that maybe folks have seen. That's really just a narrow walking path, but does provide some opportunities for us to build off of in terms of making particular connectivity through some parts of Ashland. So that's a good segue to some of what we see as the key issues here in Ashland as we're beginning our work. And our analysis really has begun and will continue for really the next month or so as we're analyzing and assessing conditions here and looking at opportunities for the connectivity, knowing the challenges that we face and the lack of rail corridor, as Joel talked about. So we know that, the first key issue I wanted to just highlight a little bit, just so you understand some of our thinking and where we've gone in some of our sort of initial thoughts about a potential trail alignment in some parts of the town. We know that this is a really key goal of the committee and of the town itself. Is to provide strong linkages to the various destinations in the town, including the state parks. Your middle and high school, of course, are generally along the alignment. We know people want to get to the MBTA station, and there's a project that's just under construction now to improve walking and biking connectivity to the T station. And then, of course, to downtown. And that's really where I want to focus on for the next handful of slides. And both the map on the previous page, for those who haven't been to a table yet, both the larger scale map of the full town, and then the blow up zoomed in of the sort of central part of Ashland and the downtown area. These are the two maps that you'll be able to look at more closely and mark up later. As you get to the individual tables. But as we zoom into downtown and look at it very carefully, because we know that this is, again, a key goal for the community, is how to bring folks on bike and walking, not just through and adjacent to downtown on the Upper Charles Trail itself, but are there opportunities for spur trails or potentially just a downtown area mini loop? So you have the larger 30-mile Upper Charles Trail loop, but perhaps there's maybe just a smaller 2-mile loop just around the center of Ashland. So we've looked at a number of different alignment and connection opportunities, and I want to just walk you through. I can't walk you through every single one and all the ins and outs of each of the potential connections, but I just wanted to touch upon a few of the critical ones that we've looked at, and we'd love to hear your comments on these and ones that perhaps are missing. So just to kind of take you through, again, the central part of Ashland that we focused a good portion of our energy on in the last couple weeks. So going from the Howe Street crossing of the trail to the high school, that's kind of what we're focused on here, and Stone Park is kind of that central point that we'd love to any of the options to hit at some point, because we know that that's an important public space for the community. So going west to east, all the options that we're looking at, there's really only one alignment that makes sense. There's the Shell pipeline easement that runs behind the rail transit district development that works quite well, and the grades are good, and the space is there for a nice off-road trail. When the four different options then hit the MBTA access road, we start sort of splitting into different options that we're sort of assessing each of the individual options. So a couple of the options that we're looking at, in essence, just follow to the southeast, the MBTA access road. Some of you may know, and you see some of the construction out there, that the roadway itself will be shifted over a little bit, and then a shared use path will be put alongside to help connect Route 135 to the MBTA station, which is just a great project, and certainly we want to take advantage of that potentially for some of the alignment options. So that two of the alignment options, really look at that. We then have some options where the MBTA access road hits 135. One option is to use a narrow property, potentially adjacent to Voyager's Lane, to provide access sort of around the small neighborhood off of Voyager's Lane in order to get to Ashland State Park. So we see that as a major destination. So one option for the route really through the sort of, you know, central part of the town, from the, you know, close to the MBTA station really to the high school, is to sort of route that trail in the state park, around over the dam, and then through. There's a lot of wetlands down here, so there's some real challenges there. I'm not saying any of these are really easy, but this is just the ones that we are assessing right now. So that's sort of one of the options to come through. There are two other options where the split occurs at the MBTA access road. We have sort of a 2A and a 2B, but both of them, at least around the Nyanza cap, the connection to Magunko Road, there is a short little portion of rail bed that actually runs along the southeast portion of the cap, for those that haven't seen it. And it's a nice rail bed, could work really well as a trail. It is private property, so we know that's a challenge, and that's something that would need to clearly be looked at. But it is an opportunity that, again, we're studying in order to connect down to Magunko Road. Yet another option in order to get people into downtown is utilizing West Union Street. So in the option that comes down the MBTA access road to 135, there is the option to use Summer Street and then potentially branching off to Union Street. Union Street is busy. You all know that. There are, you know, relatively generous shoulders and portions of it where you don't have turn lanes that work pretty well for bicyclists. So that's an opportunity. It's also possible perhaps to widen a sidewalk on one side, a couple extra feet just to provide a little more breathing room. So this is one segment of the downtown area we are surely looking at. Another connection after the Magunko Road to and then on Park Street, past Stone Park, we're looking at the opportunity to connect back to the Wildwood Cemetery using Homer and Chestnut Street. And while we were overlooking at Homer Street, we also thought, you know, perhaps there's an opportunity and enough space adjacent to the rail tracks, the MBTA line, which is not unprecedented. If you go to Belmont, you'll see there's sections of a trail adjacent to the MBTA tracks. But there's a little bit more space there. Here, it's a little tight with the property line, in essence, being there. You really need to have a good 10 or 15-foot setback from the tracks for the trail. So it's just a little too tight, but it was worth the investigation. But you know, Homer Street is certainly an option because of the lower volume. There's an opportunity, perhaps, to put in bike lanes, possibly even to make it a one-way road. That's something we are looking at as well, to provide the connections at the north end of down, or not north end of downtown, but north end of at least this portion of the alignment in order to get to Wildwood Cemetery, which is, and then ultimately to the play fields in the back of the high school. We've looked at Main Street, and you know, it's a reasonably decent roadway to walk on if you're coming from any of these alignments in order to get to Town Hall, to connect to the library, to go to some of the businesses. Works okay for walkers, for bicyclists probably less so just because of the traffic conditions. There isn't too much space for a shoulder or bike lane. Probably not a great one especially for bikes, but again, it's something we are assessing carefully. Again, the theme with all these is there's really no easy answers here. This is definitely one of the more challenging contexts that I've personally worked in all the trail planning I've did, and we're trying to look at just about everything. And I'm not even covering some of the little sub-options that there are a handful of them as well that sort of run in between or sort of cut off some of the angles between some of these roadways as well. What a lot of the options that we're looking at right now in this central portion of downtown arrive at the Main Street where I'm forgetting the name of the brook or the stream.
Cold Spring,
thank you. Where Cold Spring roughly crosses at Main Street. There is a little parking area, informal, of course, and there is an informal and not officially established trail, sort of a trail, I guess you could say, on the Kitty Fenwall properties, just on the other side of Cold Spring. There are definitely some opportunities there. It's flat. It's really quite pretty, right adjacent to the stream. So for three of our four options that we're routing through the downtown, we kind of bring folks to that crossing and then incorporate a potential trail. Again, it's private property right now. There'll need to be some sort of easement or agreement made. Those discussions haven't started yet, but we've sort of heard that there is some potential interest from Kitty Fenwall. So for now, we're looking at this as an opportunity with some potential to create the connection. Ultimately from Main Street or from the end of Chestnut and the Kitty Fenwall Trail, what we're trying to do is get, at least in this central portion of Ashland, to connect to the high school. The various ways of doing it, none are easy, but we've sort of looked at them. One option is East Union Street as a possible connection. Lots of busy traffic, I think you all know that. There is a sidewalk, it's relatively narrow. There's some shoulder in some area, but then it goes away, and there are some blind corners. There are some houses and properties that are some homes that are built relatively close to East Union Street that makes it more of a challenge to take, say, that narrow sidewalk and widen it out to 10 feet and make that a shared use path. We've looked at it as an option. Definitely has its significant challenges. What probably has some more opportunity that we've really looked at, and there's some real sense of interest and arguably excitement perhaps from committee members and others, is to potentially incorporate Wildwood Cemetery as, in essence, the Upper Charles Trail connection from, possibly the end of the Kitty Fenwall Trail and Chestnut Street up to the sort of back end of the high school. There are definitely some, theme of the night is there's challenges, everything I mentioned. Oh, there's challenges there. So there's an opportunity for sure. Challenges are, I think, most significantly is just the sensitivity that we as planners and I think the committee members and the town want to have in sort of treading lightly in a cemetery. So it's something we want to be cognizant of in terms of what a path or a trail, the Upper Charles Trail, may look like through a cemetery. And this is a town-owned cemetery. It has a number of paved roadways on through the cemetery. And what we're looking at, for those who really can see, it's small, but really the north end, there's a paved roadway that's on the, in essence, the far north side of the cemetery that in most cases has a significant setback from any of the grave sites. There's a few spots where it's still a roadway, so it's not as if a trail would be on new pavement next to graves, but it would still be on roadway. So we're trying to be very sensitive to that. So that is a challenge here. There are some topography issues as well. But we see an opportunity, certainly in a short term, because those roadways are already there, that it could end up being a possibility. So in an early phase, the thought is perhaps use some of the roadways with just some signage and some branding to allow people not to get lost in the cemetery, which would be important, of course. And then potentially in a later phase, a little further down the road, but in a phase that could be a year, could be however many years, but the opportunity to actually get out of the road system and closer to Cold Spring Brook. There are opportunities there for some of it may have to actually be in boardwalk because there are some floodplain issues there, but it's really a really beautiful stretch on that side of Cold Spring Brook between the brook itself and the cemetery. It's okay. Where the brook hits the river, which is right here at that confluence, then it becomes the Sudbury River. Thank you. So adjacent to the river here, which is really that image, the Sudbury River is kind of right over in there in that particular image. That gets you away from the cemetery. Then there's some hill here, so there would need to be some kind of switchbacks in potentially the edge of the cemetery property or possibly the property adjacent, if that could be potentially utilized in order to have an off-road path that's purely just for walking and biking that runs along the edge of the cemetery, just kind of skirting the edge as a real opportunity to get to the high school. Again, we mentioned that the committee is very interested in this. We as consultants think that there's some real possibilities to make this work. But we know that there's no guarantees. So at this point, as kind of a backup option at least, we still are looking at the opportunity from the Chestnut and Kitty Fenwall Trail terminus there, the possibility that the connection may, in fact, for bikes and walkers, go down Chestnut Street about a quarter mile, and then potentially utilizing a buffer connection between a number of properties adjacent to the Village of Americas in order to get to the high school. There's the high school softball field and the other fields there. So that's something that we're keeping in our back pocket, but really looking very closely at the cemetery as a real critical option. That could be an exciting one for the Upper Charles Trail. Oh, yeah, thank you. That's a bigger, yeah, thank you. So there's Cold Spring Brook, and the Kitty Fenwall Trail from Main Street kind of runs along the brook. And it comes out at Chestnut pretty much right across from the main entry to Wildwood Cemetery. So there would need to be some crossing improvement there. And then what we're looking at is either utilizing the northernmost paved road. Oh, actually, it's here. That northernmost paved roadway that does that as perhaps a interim improvement with then the possibility in studying for a second phase, it would run along the Sudbury River as the brook hits the river here, this being the Sudbury River.
There's a trail, isn't it?
There's a little bit of a walking trail back there, but not, what's that? Not for bicycles, no. Much too rugged.
When they built the high school, they intruded up on the existing trail.
There is some existing path and trail here, yes.
So why redesign and reroute it?
When we get to the key is to get from Chestnut, in essence, to the high school property.
Land adjacent to what you described, Kitty Fenwall, that's town land. So we don't have to deal with Kitty Fenwall. We own that land.
Yep.
Can you describe it as being Kitty Fenwall land?
The Kitty Fenwall property, I don't know where the property line is, but it's somewhere in here.
There's no Kitty Fenwall property there. It's all kind of Ashland property.
We'll look at that.
Thank you. I mean, we'll look at that because that could be quite significant. We'll definitely take a look. Thank you for bringing that up. That's a good point. So that was the option is to, in a later phase, run along the river and then kind of double back and do some switchbacks to sort of arrive at the point about there at the south end of the softball field. So that was kind of I mentioned that our focus of our assessment, existing conditions analysis has really been on sort of the central, let's call it the central one-third of the portion of the trail that I want to sort of walk you through. And, we'd love to hear your comments about any of the potential areas that could be used in town for the Upper Charles Trail from end to end. But we also have the larger scale map of the more central area for more detailed comments as well. So I mentioned there were six key issues. Maybe you forgot about that. So I brought the slide back. And these are quick, these are more kind of one or two slides. These are some of the other key issues that we're really looking at in our assessment and what we want to tackle as we move forward and coming up with some preliminary recommendations, which we do want to bring back to the community in really just 6 or 7 weeks. So closing gaps, key gaps in the route. The reality is, as you've already seen in some of my description, that there is a likelihood where some on-road connections may be needed. There's only so much, you know, state property, town property, or even private property with easements that could be used for an off-road trail. So we know that we may need to look at on-street facilities. There's sort of a toolbox of different options that we typically would use, ranging from having some wider sidewalks. If there's space, that can be a challenge with utility poles, but if there's space, there's cycle tracks, which are sort of like very similar to shared use paths, but you can see that instead of a wider sidewalk being sort of a shared use path, perhaps for bikes and pedestrians, a cycle track is really more of a dedicated space for bikes and an adjacent dedicated space for walking. Of course, there's opportunities for shoulders and bike lanes, and then on some other roadways, especially with lower volumes and lower speeds, you can put in perhaps a striped shoulder and or shared lane markings, which are some people call sharrows, which are the kind of bike stencil with a chevron adjacent to it, just to inform motorists that bicyclists should be expected to be using the roadway. And for bicyclists, it sort of guides them to where a safe position is on the road as well. So this is kind of a toolbox of different options we might use for, especially for bike-related improvements for the on-street connections, which are really a key feature here. Another key issue is the prioritization. We're going to be developing a whole bunch of different options and sub-options, and we need to have some sort of methodology to come up with, use an objective methodology to come up with recommendations. So we typically do a prioritization and evaluation matrix where we list all the different sort of options and sub-options on one side, and we develop criteria that we use to score each of those options to see how each of them score in total relative to each other. Usually the scores add up to 30 or 50 or 100 points, depending on how we set that up. So that's one thing we'll be doing as we move forward in the next couple months. There are various environmental challenges that need to be looked at. I'm sure you all know, and I've mentioned it, there's wetlands in a number of places. So we'll need to look at some solutions, such as some boardwalk connections, which can be 6 to 10 feet wide, various types of design. I think that will be probably a pretty critical factor in some parts of Ashland. But there are places where there are streams and brooks, and of course there's the Sudbury River. There are some sites that have some underground contamination, so those we're going to need to look at carefully in any of our recommendations. There are places we have mapped out on GIS, places where there are vernal pools, which obviously provide a really key habitat, especially in the springtime, for all kinds of critters. And there are a handful of historic archaeological sites. We've mapped many of these out. Kleinfelder will be helping us a lot with sort of developing strategies to overcome some of these issues in terms of permitting. But we'll also be looking at routing strategies that may try to avoid some of these sensitive environmental challenges as well. There are road crossings in a number of places. There's sort of five critical ones here: Howe Street, High, West Union, Main Street, and 126. In almost all the different scenarios we look at, we're going to have to deal with the trail crossing these roads. In some cases, the routing will be such that they're crossing at existing signals, but not in all cases. So that's something we're going to need to pay particular attention to. We've done a lot of this kind of planning and design for those that ride a little bit in along the Emerald Necklace or in Boston a little bit more. We did the design for the new Route 9 or the Emerald Necklace crossing at Route 9, which is a kind of a critical trail, Olmsted Trail crossing at Route 9 that was horrible for many, many decades. It's now been redesigned and rebuilt. If you're ever in that area, check it out. Something we did. Last thing that's sort of the critical issue that, our main task right now is really the alignment and the routing. and coming up with recommendations, but as we move forward, we want to talk about some character, design character, and the coherence of a trail. I mean, a real challenge in an environment like this, where you have state forests and you have roadway connections, and you have pieces of trail on some short stretches of rail bed and through cemeteries, is how do you make it all sort of a coherent design? So that's something we'll be looking at in terms of branding and signage and just the overall design of the trail. It's likely that you'll get bits and pieces of all of these and maybe even more within the Upper Charles Trail. Just in Ashland itself, it's not going to be like Milford, where from end to end it's a paved 10-foot wide trail. There are likely to be some portions like that in town, but others might be more of a stone dust, more of a natural surface stone dust. Some may be unimproved, especially in state parks perhaps, in other places. And then of course we have boardwalks that we know are likely in a number of spots as well. So that kind of went through what we are seeing right now is some of the key planning and analysis issues that we focused on and will continue to focus on. Wanted to make sure everyone understood what the schedule is on this project. You can see on this calendar, if you can't read that, so here's February. We kind of started the project and had our kickoff meeting with the committee and with the town. We have our public forum, not public meeting, that was here today, March 30th. And we'll be developing a lot of the alignment alternatives and recommendations really in the next month and a half, 2 months. And we already have plans, I think, in this room, correct? Back in this room on May 18th, we already have the room secured, and that will be our second public meeting where we'll be presenting to you again those alignment options and some evaluation. And then we will come back with a final presentation of all the final recommendations sometime in July. We also have, in terms of public engagement, besides the website, which I'll give you that address in just a second, we have in our scope of work two outreach events where we're going out to the community sometime in the summer at perhaps the farmers market or the MBTA station, we'll see, during commute times, with information, engaging people, asking them questions, getting additional feedback. So that's something you can keep your eye out for me and Charlie and others sometime in June or July at some of those events. And as I said, just to conclude, show you this again, as I said, a part of our public engagement is the website. This is the website, ashlandbikeclub.com/Upper Charles Trail Committee. If you go there, you will see a number of links to studies and to videos. There are trail fact sheets. There's a whole bunch of PDFs of different potential alignments, maps that Joel and the committee have put onto that site over the last few months. Again, they started it, a year ago, at least, that website, and we've built upon it. You can also go in there, and there's a Contact Us tab where you can provide more feedback beyond what you're able to give us tonight. So please visit the website. And I thank you for your patience in the presentation. And as I mentioned before, we want to open the floor for 20 minutes for some just general Q&A. And I'd like to invite Joel up and maybe Rob, perhaps to, or you can stay seated if you want, to perhaps answer some of the questions. And then at about 8:30, we'll break up and allow people to go again to any of the three corners, or the two corners in the back and the one up here. All the maps are the same. And we'd love to just get more of your comments and get them down on paper. So thank you so much, and happy to take questions. Yes. Yes, ma'am. Oh, and let me, I should, yeah. You wanna, we're going to hand around the mic. Which mic? Okay. When you speak in the mic, you have to put it really, really close to your mouth, like almost right on your lips, just FYI, okay. But thank you.
Where does the trail connect to Hopkinton or Sherburn? How does it go from one town to another?
That's something we're still evaluating, but Hopkinton, the connection will happen somewhere within or adjacent to Hopkinton State Park is generally the rough plan right now. And on the Sherburn side, The alignment of the trail, let's see, does it show up? Yeah, on the Sherburne side, you know, I talked a lot about the need to connect to the high school, either the front side or the back side of the high school. There are some utility easements, power lines that we're likely to go through in order to connect and cross at 126 somewhere near the Market Basket in this area here. And then we're looking at different options to connect then further west into Sherburne. And I know there's a rail yard or rail tracks there too.
Just one of those areas which we've really, I think, is in pretty good shape is the so-called Dyke Trail. If you know that, where that is across from Market Basket, that's pretty much where it's going to be going. That's really a beautiful trail. That's one of our areas that really seems to be in place.
Get the whole group up here. I just want to tell people where the Dyke Trail is. If you've never been on it, it's really probably, maybe it's arguable, but maybe the most beautiful place in Ashland. You feel like you're in the Everglades there. It's unbelievable. And it's very easy to find it. It's not that safe to find it. So if you're at Market Basket and you start walking toward Shaw's, toward Elliott Street, on the left-hand side up maybe 100 yards or so, you can't miss it driving by. There's a break in the guardrail. It's 42-inch opening there. It's the only break in the guardrail. And if you walk down there and go down that trail for like a mile or two, it's really something beautiful, swamps and wetlands, and it's very scenic. One thing, we're looking at two different possible routes to connect to Sherburne. One is straight over that trail, and it hits the Sherburne line. The target, whichever way we go, is to get to what Phil had talked about earlier, the Whitney Street Bridge on Whitney Street, the extension of Elliott Street, if you will. That's where we're trying to get to, because that trail then goes all the way to downtown Holliston and beyond. And it's right now it's a wide open, abandoned rail bed. It's very walkable. So anyway, we also have one other option we've discovered recently. And we haven't explored it in any detail, so we're not sure how viable it is. But there is a trail, if we don't go straight to Sherburne, that cuts over and hits Elliott Street or Whitney Street, right near where the town line is over there. So we're going to explore all possibilities to figure out what's the most economical, the best scenery, the best slopes. I mean, there's a lot of things to consider.
Great question. Other questions?
Just a couple questions. So yeah. This presentation, will that be available up on the website?
Will be sometime next week for sure. Yep.
Okay. And you mentioned a matrix you showed earlier with different attributes to help you assess, the ideal path.
Yep.
All the attributes, are they weighted the same? And, how heavily weighted are things like, possibly having it go through the no disturb buffer zone?
Yeah, well, we haven't developed the criteria yet. Typically, when we develop that criteria, we work with the client and or the committee, in this case, to discuss weighting and what is, more important and what is perhaps less important to people. Usually, something like, safety or connectivity to key destinations frequently sort of comes up in ways, gets sort of a double or maybe a triple weighting. But sometimes in this process, we'll develop, 7, 8, 10 criteria, and all of them will, in essence, be weighted the same. They'll all be worth, say, 10 points, and then they add up to 100. So I can't say how that will come out next. But certainly one of the criteria is always, community support for any portions of the trail when we're evaluating each of the segments. So that's certainly the issue of the buffer would come into play there for sure.
My concern is that I will be on a butter.
Close to you.
Concern is that I will be on a butter from the Cold Spring, from the State Park, Metropolitan Ave, Cold Spring down to Main Street. So I'm on Warren Road, so I abut Cold Spring. So how are my neighbors will be protected? Okay, if you build a trail and all kinds of people, different people going through. I don't want anyone to go camping and starting a farm, burning the whole neighborhood. And again, would I have to, my responsibility to post signs, probably property all along the trail? Okay, how are the neighbors going to be protected?
Yeah,
butters.
Yep, good question. Certainly, and you know, this is not a final design process. This is more of a preliminary routing study, but you know, in our recommendations, typically at this level of planning and design, we include a section that gets into, and I should have, you know, now that you mentioned it, I probably should add a slide in there. When we talk about the coherency of the trail and the different options for designing the trail, we'll have recommendations for what different segments of the trail may look like, but just as importantly, and probably more importantly for someone like you, is what do the edges of the trail look like? You know, the trail will be within some sort of alignment, easement, or property, and at those edges, we want to look at and make recommendations for whether it's a taller, more secure fence, or whether it's just a more rustic-looking split rail fence. We want to have landscaping that maybe is dense enough that isn't so easy for people to get through it. Frequently, when dealing with abutter concerns, we'll plan or design, because we certainly do some final design, we'll design berms and other landscape buffers so that visually any of the abutters, especially residential abutters, don't necessarily have the visual presence. So those are things that will be part of the overall recommendations, is how to create an appropriate visual and secure buffer between the trail and adjacent properties. Yeah.
Hi, I have a question about the connection going by the cemetery and going back to the high school.
Okay. So
I guess my question is more for the bike committee, but you're part of the process. Have they presented to the Ashland School Committee? And if they have not done so yet, are they planning to get on their agenda? If they've already presented, did they get a response? I don't think that there's enough land and room for the path to go behind the high school there.
So the short answer to your question is we've had an ongoing dialogue for more than a year, both with the school committee and with Superintendent Adams. One of our committee members, who I think is here somewhere out there, I can't see, oh, there he is, way in the back, Rick Hampson. It would be good for you to speak with him and get real details from him about the conversations he's been having. But he's been talking with Jim Adams, the superintendent of schools, on an ongoing basis. Rick and I did appear before the school committee, I'm not sure of the time frame, roughly a year ago. They're very aware of what our goals are. We have Alta here to study all possible routes in town. Our committee was looking at a route that did go through the back of the high school. There are a couple of different options there. And I can tell you that the feedback we received when we went to the school committee, this is probably on their website, if we could find, I'd be happy to try to find the date. You might, I think it maybe was videotaped, I'm not sure. That they were very excited with the idea of trying to connect the school. They have an ongoing program in Ashland right now called Safe Routes to School. And this is a very important thing. We just had a high school kid get killed along the train tracks in Ashland. Kids are out, you know, it's really not safe on many streets in town for bicycle riding. We lack sidewalks in many areas. So to be able to find a mechanism to safely get kids where they could, if they chose to, get to school in the morning, get home at night, maybe leave school and go to the state parks or to downtown or shopping or whatever their interests might be, without having to wait for a ride every time or wait for the school bus, we see that as a major plus for the town. Are there issues with regard to the size and amount of space and how that's going to all be engineered? Absolutely. That's why we have experts here to help us plan whether that can be done safely, and if so, exactly what the best way to do it is. So there aren't answers right now, nothing is definite, but I want to assure you that we have been in regular contact with the schools, and they are, subject to the details of the final plan, they're very excited about having us try to route the trail and provide this as a resource to the students. Thanks.
So a question over here. I'm a member of a couple of bicycle forums, and recently there was a discussion about riding through cemeteries and whether it was disrespectful, respectful. I guess if you can comment on, and the commentary was all over the place, but can you discuss other trails that you're familiar with that go through cemeteries, that have been successfully routed through cemeteries? And if I understood your presentation, you were looking at that possibly as a short-term measure and then long-term moving the trail?
Yeah, so just to clarify at least the second part of the question, yes, so this is probably the best image. In the short term, utilizing the cemetery road that's sort of furthest to the north and closest to the Sudbury River, because it's already paved, and in fact, I think it's getting repaved sometime this year, a portion of it, that it could work reasonably well, very, very small footprint in terms of establishing it as a trail with just some minor signs or possibly some small roadway markings. There's not a lot of precedence that I know of for trails that go through cemeteries from end to end. There are cemeteries frequently are used for recreation in a number of communities, probably more for walking than anything else. Some, I know in Arlington, we have a cemetery that is open to bicycling. It's not part of a major trail, so you don't see a lot of bikes in there. I do know, I used to live in Portland, Oregon, where our company is headquartered, and there is a major cemetery, and it's privately owned, where this, of course, is public, which perhaps makes it a little easier to route some sort of walking and bike connection through. But I know that is one of the primary bike routes in the southwest part of town, is actually through negotiations that the city had with the owners of the cemetery to actually allow sort of bike access through there as a pretty primary recreational and commuter route. I'm sure there are others. That literally is the only one I am familiar with. I'd love to see some of the commentary in that forum. It sounds interesting because I know it's not a typical situation. For sure, and that's one of the challenges we're dealing with here.
Sure.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I think maybe one of the things we ought to think about is kind of a special initiative to get more information or feedback from people about this, because I think it's a very sensitive area. I do want to, Steve's question reminded me where my parents are buried in Acton. It's about, there's a trailhead about 50 yards from there. Their gravestones, where people just drive up and park and go walking through the woods. So that's it's not exactly the same thing, but there's an area where they have integrated a recreational thing where people drive through the cemetery road and park at the end of the cemetery and walk from a path there and bring their dogs and all. Seems to be working okay. It's, that's just a similar. Right.
Yeah, and there's no cycling allowed in Mount Auburn, but there's lots of walking. It's one of my favorite places to walk, actually. Yeah. We will definitely do some research and look into this, because I think it's an important question, and we need to understand, other than that one in Portland that I think has been pretty successful, because I know it's a multi-year fight, and it's been probably 7 or 8 years since it's been open, but there's bound to be some other options, and we want to look into that to see how it works. So, great question.
For those areas that currently exist in a natural state, say through the state park, the dike trail you talked about, and on Howe Street, are you proposing to affect those in any way and change their natural state and pave them or do anything to them?
Maybe. I think that's a conversation we definitely need to have with DCR. I mean, that's DCR, at least the state parks. I don't know, the dike trail, do you have a sense of whose ownership?
We have an easement.
It's an easement, okay. So that's a town-owned property, or a town easement. We need to, at some point, have a meeting with DCR to get a sense for what they might be open to and interested in and what's environmentally appropriate in those places. I think, going back to the trail coherency, this one, I mean, I would imagine that it's quite likely. I mean, some of those trails look like this now. In fact, this is a photo from I think the Ashland State Park, or maybe Hopkinton, but I think Ashland State Park. I think it's possible, depending on environmental constraints that may exist adjacent, that some of this may end up looking more like that as a recommendation. I mean, there's no guarantee these things will happen. And again, it will take the cooperation of DCR. DCR is unlikely to have funding to do these kind of trail improvements, so there would have to be some sort of partnership with DCR. So I hope that answers your question. I would suspect that you're probably not going to see a paved trail with stone dust shoulders through the state parks, but that's to be seen.
So will the residents of the town have any weigh-in on that, or just DCR?
Good question. And yes, I think for sure it isn't just, you know, we as the consultants or maybe the committee negotiating with DCR. It's a great question, and for those who feel strongly one way or the other, we definitely want to hear some of that, and there is the question on the comment form about this. We do want to hear from the community if there's a strong feeling toward one way or the other towards the portions of trail that may run through the state parks.
Well, I think she was really not just concerned specifically about the state parks, but about Howe Street and a couple of the small dike trails. Those are not state park stuff, so those are all things where the whole town would be involved.
For sure. I mean, this is the beginning of that discussion, so we hope to get more feedback from others.
And I'd like to remind everyone about the half-size sheet here, the community comment form, which Phil just mentioned. Yep. Question four is, what is your preferred trail surface character? There are four options, and if these don't suit you, I recommend you write one in. As we compile the data that we receive from these community comments, this will make it into our analysis and part of our report. So I just want to make a plug. If you haven't filled one of these out, please do so. This data is really valuable as we weigh the trail surface options.
Question in the back on the right. We want to get to people first, and then we can get to you again, sir.
Hi. I currently live as an abutter to the currently zoned do not disturb zone, buffer zone.
Okay.
So my question for you is, when you construct the path, how wide is it, and how wide is the stone dust shoulder that you mentioned?
Well, again, if the portion of the buffer that you're referring to is the recommended alignment, which is a big question mark, but if it is, then the second question is, what would we recommend in terms of the trail design? And again, similar to the previous question, we want to hear from the community what your interests are in terms of whether what would be preferred is a paved trail or a stone dust trail. If it is, to specifically answer your question, if you're talking about a paved trail, typically the stone dust shoulders are 18 inches on each side, but I've seen some communities do something wider that provides a little more of a running surface. So that would be, it could be any of these options, to be honest, if the buffer is chosen as the recommended alignment.
But as an expert, what is the typical width of a standard bike path? Because there's only 140 feet in that buffer right now, and my property line goes right up to it. So I'm just trying to get a sense.
Okay.
Well, what I'm going to be looking at.
Well, it's like 10.
And then one more question to add to that. What do you take down in terms of foliage next to that path so that I can also account for that?
Yeah. Typically you have what's called the tread, the trail tread, which it could be various materials, could be stone dust, could be paved. But generally you're talking about a tread that's 10 to 14 feet itself. And then the standards are for a minimum of a 2-foot buffer clearance on each side, so anyone riding a bike or skating or whatever doesn't, hit anything. And that includes signage or trees. So I guess in a worst-case scenario, if your interest is maintaining, retaining that buffer as much as possible, would be something like in the order of about 20 feet.
Wow.
Yeah. And that's not to say that it can't be routed in a way to avoid larger trees or if there is a vernal pool or something in there. So, that would be, that's sort of the maximum envelope. But again, depending on what community is interested in, our recommendation could be something narrower than that. And I wanted to get to you, sir, and then we'll get to you too, ma'am. Here, I'll give you the...
Just expounding on the DCR. That we are going to provide it. One of the options is from Metropolitan Ave across the dam and down Cold Spring towards the Main Street. So we'll have to negotiate and interact with DCR. So here we are. This is a very active senior center, but the gate is just 100 feet, 200 feet down, where yep. the seniors don't have access to the state park most of the year. So maybe negotiate with the CR so the seniors have the opportunity to enjoy the state park after, what is it, May 30th, whenever they close the state park. Okay, maybe that could be negotiated with the
state. Okay, that's a good idea. Yep. Okay. Charlie, the woman in the pink, purple sweater.
I have two questions. Does this have to be approved by town meeting, or has it already been approved? It seems like a big project. And how is this going to be funded?
I guess I'll let Rob answer the in terms of the process, what happens politically with our report, our recommendations in the next 6 months.
Well, I think you gave me the easy one. Typically, these kinds of projects are multi-year and funded from a variety of sources. So, depending on the funding, it'll be going to town meeting. Whether it gets into a capital plan, whether we apply for grants, whether we try to get state funds. One of the ways we're looking at building this would be in phases, and you would have temporary measures. Phil talked about being on the roads, maybe particular. So that may be something the town does informally. So. This is really a multi-stage process. I think one of the things, phase two would be talking about, actually going to detailed plan and design, and from that you then look for the funding. But the first thing is to try to find a route that is at least somewhat plausible, and maybe doing the low-hanging fruit. Like the dike trail is pretty much ready to go, depending on what we want to do there. The question is, where does it go to? It has to connect somewhere. So. In that case, for example, we have to wait for the 126 project where they're going to put a crossing in there, so align with that. So there's all. This is a multi-year process. It's not just like, oh, we're going to town meeting one day and we're going to do the whole project. I don't see that happening. So
you'll go multiple times?
It depends on the funding. I mean, and it depends if that particular appropriation requires town meeting, for example. I don't think we've thought about it in that kind of detail yet. We're trying to go on to design.
It's a real mixed bag. There's also MassDOT funding as part of a complete streets program that Ashland is not formally part of yet, but there's likely discussions in town where certainly some of the roadway elements, not just on state highways, but there is, theoretically down the road, there could be opportunities for some of the on-road improvements to be funded through MassDOT Complete Streets funding program, too. Yes, in the back, sir.
Hi. As far as the Do Not Disturb zone, I'm trying to understand if the bylaws say that have deemed that as a no-disturb zone, I'm trying to understand how that's even an option and why that's even being discussed, frankly.
It's my understanding that there is, I probably won't give a great answer, but it's my understanding that the planning board is able to approve a potential trail in that zone, that there's something in the language of that agreement that allows that to happen. So it's not sort of, it can't just be done right now, but through the whole planning board approval process could theoretically be something that's viable.
It would be wonderful. They can come to our yards and come sit with us at night as strangers are riding through. I invite them all over.
They could do that. That Great. Sounds like a good time. Any other questions?
First you and then over.
Since he's got the mic. And then over to
I have two, if it's okay.
Yep.
So I live very close to, I would be in a butter and very close to a crossing, and I was just wondering, if you could talk a little bit about the different options there are for the signals, the traffic signals, because it's sort of a concern of mine. You know, right now there's no signal there, and late at night. I know there are different options. They can be automated, or you can have something that's operated with a button or something. But just wondering about that. And then also, is the scope of this project, does it include any parking areas to access the rail trail?
For the latter question, we, in our recommendation, we normally would pinpoint areas where we think it's a good idea, and there's space for some sort of trailhead and small parking area. And a trailhead usually would have a kiosk and some bike racks and a bench or two. So yeah, that would be part of our recommendations for sure. Was there a first? What was the first?
The crossings.
Oh, and the crossings.
Right.
Yeah, there. You know, we'll have recommendations for what is likely an appropriate crossing treatment. If it's a roadway where, you know, depending on the volume and the speed of traffic, maybe it just becomes a high visibility crosswalk. In other cases, maybe we would advocate for a pedestrian or trail user activated signal or even a flashing beacon.
Okay.
So those are, you know, three of the options in all likelihood. Yes, in the far back.
Yep. I believe that I saw somewhere Mount Feek Cemetery in Waltham is at least like an easement for a trail, the Blue Heron.
Oh, okay.
So you might want to look that
okay.
up. I couldn't find it, though, on the internet. And then my question is regarding the, you mentioned the switchback sort of on the option where the trail runs along the brook north of the cemetery to need the switchback. What's
yep.
sort of like the grade, the maximum grade that you do at the switchback? And are there any other areas in Ashland that you feel might need that?
You know, we haven't looked at all of the different alignment options to know where the topographical challenges are enough that we would probably need a switchback, but or two. That would be one for sure. And, you know, when the switchbacks are designed, you know, with the trail, ideally we want to keep it as a ADA accessible trail. There are exceptions for short stretches of trail to go up to 8%, in some cases 10 or 12% for very short stretches. And some of that depends too on the funding source. So if the trail is sort of considered and the funding source considers it a transportation enhancement, then from end to end it needs to be ADA, sort of 5%, 5% grade, which is the standard ADA slope on a ramp. But if the funds are coming locally or through some recreational appropriations, then there's a little bit more leeway to have some shorter stretches that are a bit steeper. So it's going to depend on the funding source to some degree. Okay, I want to take two more questions because we want to have time for people to get to the tables and give us their comments on the maps. Thanks.
Hi, I'm new to Ashland. What are these do not disturb zones?
Well, I could show you roughly where they are, and I don't know, there's probably 10 people in the room that want to answer that, but let me just at least show you. Maybe I'll hand it to
what
Joel.
What makes them a do not disturb
okay.
zone?
I'm serious.
If you can give us a clear and objective answer, sure, and I'll find the map here.
So it probably started in 2001 through 2008, because I went to about 60 of these meetings with our neighbors. That parcel of land where you see the density of all that building.
It's this strip, this sort of buffer zone.
Right. So here. Fafford was the developer. He's built a lot of condos in town. He had that whole parcel of land, 74 acres, where he had it as industrial, which he knew he couldn't build on, because he had been trying and it just didn't happen over 15 or 20 years. And then he also had it as mixed-use special district with 25% residential and 75% commercial. And he didn't want to do that because he knew he could build condos, and that's where he was going to make his money, and he'd already done that three or four times in the town. So he needed a zoning change. And so at that point, he had to work with the planning board and also work with the abutters to basically negotiate a deal. And what ended up happening was the buffer zone originally for industrial, if you can believe it, was only like 25 or 50 feet. And we negotiated with the town, we worked together collectively, and we ended up where the zoning change happened in 2008 whereby he was allowed to build 75% residential and 25% commercial. So on the left side of that, you see a couple of white buildings. That's his commercial space. And when it was presented to us, all of the pictures looked wonderful, and we were going to have this great mixed use like it was Lexington, and it didn't turn out that way. He just built the one story. Ultimately, he got what he was looking for, and during that time, we negotiated in good faith language, and we must have said it a million times, to have no disturb specifically written into the bylaw, and there's also an additional covenant that Fafford was willing to do to give the east side, which is the right side, an additional 50 foot of buffer, okay? So the right side's 150, the bottom side's 100. When they showed all of the pictures of what a great mixed-use district this was gonna be, they had nice little waterfalls, and then they had a gazebo, and they had people riding bikes. So when we were talking about no disturb, we were also concerned about the end of Cataract and getting cut, a road cut at the end of Cataract into the development. A lot of meetings over that, and they basically said, if you put no disturb there, that won't happen, okay? So we negotiated for that, and that is why many of us are here saying it's not like that zoning law was around for 100 years and we just moved in. It was because we negotiated in good faith, okay? And the planning board at that time, we worked with them, and we worked with the selectmen, and it went to a town vote, and it passed, okay? So that's the history behind it. And that's why we're sort of adamant that our concerns are at least considered. And I'm also thankful for Joel and the bike committee to reach out to Alta to see what can be done and all the different possibilities.
Okay, great, thank you. Fair enough. And there was one last question, and then we wanna give people the opportunity. Oh, I guess Joel wants a follow up. And then did someone else have a, I thought I saw another, no? No other questions. Joel's gonna have the last word. And then we're going to break up, and please go to one of the corners and give us some of your comments and mark up these maps. Thank you.
I just want to address this issue head on, and I hope that the residents who are here from the Fatima Drive area and from the Village of the Americas area talking about the buffer have always felt that they can always come to our meetings and present really at as much length and time as they want to make their case. We're open to hearing that. You, at our, a couple of meetings back, we took a sense of the committee vote. Our committee realizes the sensitivity of going through the cemetery as an alternate path. But we recognize very clearly the concerns that you folks are raising. We're on your side. The way we define our criteria is to minimize the cost to the residents in terms of private property and all of that stuff that's very difficult to deal with, and to minimize the impact on every resident of Ashland. That's what we're trying to do. Having said that, though, you know, I know this is never well received when I bring up this point. If you read the bylaw, if you read, you've talked at great length about negotiating with the planning board and the original intent and the do not disturb. We hear that, and we care about that. But it also has one other factor. If we have no alternate way to go, I want to point out that one of the criteria in the agreement that you reached with the planning board is that the only people who can disturb the do not disturb buffer is the planning board itself. That's what's written in the agreement. So we're not trying to do that. We're trying to find an alternate path that was actually suggested to us by some of the residents in your neighborhood. And we're hoping to be able to go a different route here. There are a lot of advantages to not going through the buffer, and we hope to be able to avail ourselves of that. That's our goal. If we had to go through the buffer, and if we felt that it was do or die, if there were no viable alternative, and personally I'm concerned about going up East Union Street. I don't think that's a very real option. I think it's a little too dangerous there, because you're talking about going two different directions, up and down the hill there. Then our goal would be to minimize the impact on the neighbors. Phil talked about berms and other methods. I know that there was, in the original agreement with Fafford, that there was talk about planting and maintaining plantings and that they were not maintained. Well, this would be a town project, not a private developer project. And, you know, I can assure you that I would be doing everything I could possibly do, and I'm sure the committee would as well, to increase the amount of screening that you currently have, not reduce it. You know, it's a valid concern you raised about we're going to cut down some trees to put a path in if we were going to do this at all. And in reality, if we were doing anything like that, our goal would be to increase the screening there and maintain the plants and ensure that you're ending up with a better situation than you have right now, even if you don't necessarily feel that way yourselves. That's the spirit of the committee, is that that's what our approach would be. And again, that's not where we're trying to go at this time. Thank you.